Now let's make our entrance into the Acton Boxborough PIP STEM Discover STEM program.
You can pick where you want.
Hello, would you like to give us a few quick words about your exhibition?
I would love to.
All right,
that's cool. So this is about residential architecture, but it's architecture and technology and how to communicate design to your clients so that they understand. And we've got some hand-built models, but I've also got a lot of computer programs that that allow us to communicate the design intent with the clients. And so should I hold it or no? You're giving it to me.
You can take it.
So it's kind of fun. I can show you one real quick thing if that want to see the sketch. So one program we use is called SketchUp. So what I'm able to do is this is a house that's under construction. This is a set of working drawings which we use engineers and civil engineers to produce. But to show the clients this project on the inside, I'll start a little animation for you. And we'll start, there we go. So we can kind of take a tour through the inside of the house, if it goes. There we go. So this is the family we walk into in the fireplace. These are actually 6 foot tall windows, so they're very tall. I've got the ceiling above. Now we're looking in through the dining room. There's no table there yet. And then off into the kitchen, stairs going up. And we use this to kind of show the different materials and cabinetry and the volume of the space and how the ceiling is soffitted. And it just allows the homeowners to really get a sense what they're going to be getting when the project's over. So I think it's a real value to them, and it's a real handy thing for us. So it's kind of a fun thing to share.
Wait, so quick question.
Yeah.
How long would it take to make this?
So this was probably the product about 40 hours of someone.
Wow.
I think it could have been done faster by someone who knew the program better. But I think this is about 40 hours. But what's kind of cool is I'll stop this. And go extents, and let's take the roof off. And let's go up. But we can kind of look at it from up above. And again, fly in. And what's kind of fun is I'll grab this person right here. I just pop them right down in the place, and it comes down right where the person is, and then we can kind of walk around. But anyway, it's a cool thing to show clients and let them see what they like.
Thank you so much for your time.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Okay, so we're gonna go to the gym. To learn about robots. Excuse me?
Yep.
Would you like to say a few words about your exhibit for Acton TV?
Well, I would indeed. Hi, my name is Ken Stafford. I'm here at WPI, and we're here with our robot called the Pack Goat. This is a robot built by Mass Academy of Math and Science High School students in 2014. Unfortunately, none of our students are here today. They're in a meeting. But we're glad to have all these kids here get a chance to drive this robot. Again, this robot, I'm a professor at WPI, but this robot's made by high school students at the Mass Academy of Math and Science, and we're really happy to help have a good time with the STEM education plan here at Acton Boxborough, right? So thank you. So you want to see it drive? Yeah, we're putting a new battery in it right now. Any of those got some charge? Alrighty, so right now we're taking a little break here because we have to change the battery of our robot. But right now, here's our controls. So you come over, step over here. You will see that this gentleman's going to be our driver. He's got two joysticks. Now, turn and look at the camera. Now, see those? That's what you call joysticks. He smiles. This is important because you put your hands there. This is going to make the robot drive forward or backward. If you want to turn, you simply push one backward and one forward, right? Now, these triggers will fire off the lasers and the weapons. You don't want to fire the lasers, right? No, there's no weapons on here. There's no weapons. But those aren't to be played with. Now, over here, these are the other controls. Now, come over here. I see you have I Love Robots on there. That's good. So, what does this thing say?
Boom.
It says boom. So, when we want to shoot a ball, we hit the shoot buttons. We said we can either shoot far or we can shoot what's called medium, which is a trust shot, or you can pass shot. So you hit one of those and you hit boom when you want it to hit. Okay, you ready for that?
Yeah.
And the rest of these controls are all for collecting the ball, storing the ball, and this is for if you want to make the arm move a little bit just gently. But right now it's all disabled here. So we got a new battery coming up in here, and soon on our controls we'll know when the battery's hooked up. I think that would be excellent. So we have to wait for we have a new battery. Ben just put a new battery in. So the batteries only last during competition about 2.5 minutes. But in demonstrations, they'll last about half an hour. So we have a new battery coming in right now, and it says hooked up. So why don't we do this? We're going to go ahead and hands off the controls for a moment here, guys. We're going to enable the robot. Okay. Now then, I want you to drive slowly backwards. Ben, can you help a little bit here, Ben? No, slowly backwards. Okay, easy. We're going to turn a little bit like this. Easy, 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 easy. I want to drive forward like this. Okay, we're going to slowly backwards. Okay, you need Ben, help him out there a little bit here. We want to put it right on that mark over there. Easy. Just slowly go forward. Actually, Ben, we could probably shoot from there. Why don't we just, this is actually not too bad. Just have him back it straight up to that little frame there. And then we'll stop right there. Back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up. Pull back, pull back. Okay, good. Now hands off. Okay, now, who's going to, you going to catch the ball for us?
Yeah.
Okay, so you need to stand over there, aim for where the ball is. Okay, now you got this shot, in this shot, you'll see this. Okay, now you want to go far shot. Hit that first. Okay, now wait a minute. It's trying to figure out where he is. Okay, now you're going to count down to five, right?
Yeah.
Five, four, three, two, one, bam! Whoa, nice shot. Very good. Okay? All right.
Thank you.
You bet.
So over here.
Can you tell us a little about your exhibit?
Wild Aware's goal is to increase community awareness of shared habitats in order to protect and conserve our wild and native animals.
The purpose is to educate the community about the existence and habitats of wild creatures with whom we share our natural resources.
This is Action Naturally. It's an introduction to familiar species. And it's available in the school store for about $6, I believe.
This is a guide to conservation lands, and it can be found at the National Resources Center in the town hall for $10.
Cheap price to pay for knowledge. Excuse me, would you like to say a few words about your exhibit?
Sit here and play on my phone. That's great. I hope you're going to edit that out.
Sure. What would you like to know?
Explain your exhibit.
So my name is Dan Strollo, and I run In Control, and we do crash prevention training. So what we want to do is see you just before you go for your license test and teach you how to stay in control of your car in an emergency. So what we do is we take new drivers primarily, hopefully, you know, while they're still in their permit, but even if you have your license, you're still plenty of time to train with us. And we put you in emergency situations with our instructor sitting next to you. It's a 4.5-hour program, and you get the opportunity to go through this stuff. And when you're done, you got a 70% less likely to crash chance than you would have if you just did traditional driver's ed. Excuse me. So we're sponsored by a lot of great area companies. Littleton Toyota, Danny's Place, a nonprofit sponsor, the police department to help reduce the cost of the training. We're a nonprofit ourselves, so we work with people to help them afford it. And really, we just want to work with all the new drivers in town. Excuse me. And help them avoid crashes. Cool?
Yeah.
Are you ready? When are you getting your license? Anyways.
I'm 13.
You're 13, so here's what I want you to do. In the next couple of years, right now when you get in the car with your parents, you've got your cell phone, and you're probably hanging out in the back seat playing on your cell phone. Spend some time up front, tell your parents to let you sit up front more than they are already, and have them teach you how to drive.
I always actually sit up front, and my dad, he has a manual car, so I always shift the gears.
Oh, there we go, that's cool.
And then whenever we we turn into our street, I always like change like the gear, and then I have to drive up the driveway.
That's even better, see?
And my brother's in fourth grade and he does that too.
The more you can do, because that doesn't go on as much nowadays, we want young people to get some experience and know what driving's like. Have your dad help you, you know, pay attention to traffic and what cars to watch out for. Even directions, you know. Sorry, geez. When you're driving and you get lost, you're not a great driver. If we can teach you how to get to and from places, that's one less thing for you to think about once you have your license. So your dad's okay. You can tell your dad he's got my...
Does the police department approve of this? Like, will they be okay?
Yeah, they're one of the sponsors. Yeah, we don't do this here. We do this in big open spaces, so there's airport runways that we offer the training. Because we want you to make mistakes and kind of feel what it's like if you were to lose control of the vehicle. So they're totally okay with the program. We train a lot of police departments as well. So that's kind of, this is something where in other countries, the U.S. actually used to be the safest place in the world to drive. Now, pretty much 40th place consistently. And the countries that have the safest roads are countries where this sort of training is mandatory. Cool?
Yeah.
Very nice meeting you.
You too. Thank you.
I'm here with Stefan Quadgrass, who's representing the Pedal Power Bike and Ski Company. Stefan, would you like to tell us a little bit about your exhibit?
So this represents two of the latest installments of bikes made by Pedal Power. And this
Hold
one...
Hold the mic.
Huh?
Hold the mic.
Okay. So basically, this bike is extremely light. The wheels will have only about 4 pounds of air pressure, which basically means the bike needs no suspension whatsoever. Combined with the bike being hollow and made of a carbonate frame, the bike can bounce over almost anything. So it can easily go through mountain trails, and also it can go through snow and sand. This bike, on the other hand, is almost completely made of carbon, including carbon wheels. Extremely light as well, even lighter than this one. And it has electronic shifting, so you're allowed to shift gears electronically, applying almost no pressure on yourself. And the battery for the electronic shifting lasts over 800 hours. It can easily be activated while pedaling. That's about all.
Yeah.
Hi, Mom!
Hello, could you give us a little information about your exhibit?
So this is the Acton Boxborough Science Team, Science Olympiad team. And so we have a bunch of our students right over here, and they're showing some of the things they've built over the years. So they'll tell you more about that. But Science Team meets every Wednesday right after school in room 258. And kids work on engineering events, chemistry problems where they have to solve, let's say, a mysterious powder by doing chemistry tests on it. Fossils, a whole bunch of different things, and we're always looking for new kids, so welcome everyone to join.
All right, thank you.
All right.
Which exhibit shall we go to? So what exactly does your presentation want to show, and what do you want to get through to people about your presentation?
So what my presentation is showing is where Acton gets its water from that we drink and use in our homes and businesses, and what water quality concerns and issues there are, and how we treat the water, how we keep the water safe. And what we have here tonight is a groundwater model that shows what's going on underneath us where our water comes from. So the groundwater model shows the loose sand and gravel that's filled in the spaces in between with water, and we pump water out through this well. And one of the things that we're demonstrating is that the water doesn't just come from that single point, but it might pull some water from over here near this stream. It might also take water from over here where we have a contamination source. And what it's demonstrating is how that water is flowing underground and getting to our supply well. And the message that we want to give people is, there are things that you can do to help keep our water clean. So think about what you're flushing down the toilet, what you're doing on your property, and also just helping people understand that when you turn on the tap in your home, that water has been tested and it's been researched and people are watching it on a regular basis. And that's what we're trying to get across to folks tonight. And there's a lot of jobs that go into it. So there's engineering and there's hydrogeology and there's water chemistry that all goes into making sure that our drinking water is safe and plentiful without hurting the environment.
So how water is getting filtered or if fluoride is being added, because I know that Acton has fluoride added into its water.
Yep, so the best way to find out what's in your water is to call us up or visit our website, actonwater.com, and we publish an annual listing of all the things and what the concentrations are in our water. And we can tell you based on either daily or monthly or quarterly testing what different types of things you can expect in the water.
Alright, well thank you.
You're welcome.
We're here with the Baseball Research Center and it's time for them to tell us a little bit about their exhibit.
So what we have here is a mini air cannon. It's a replica of one of the air cannons we have at our lab. At our lab we have a sub-loaded air cannon, and what will happen is we'll push a ball into this, and what will happen is we'll fire the ball out at this bat at a sweet spot. That red line indicates where we think the sweet spot of the bat is, whereas these green lines indicate different locations away from that sweet spot that the sweet spot could occur. So in our lab we have the inbound speed would be about 136 miles per hour. That 136 comes from the fact that this bat is stationary, and what you'd see in a real game is you'd have the bat be swinging at, in a high school level, which is what this test would be used, 66 mile per hour swing speed, 70 mile per hour pitch speed gets you the 136 that we put in. This replica is going to fire at the sweet spot, and then in the test we would fire at different locations to find the sweet spot. So what I'll do for you, can you actually pump it up for me, Cameron? Cameron will pump up this for you, and we have a ball loaded. We used a muzzle loading to load the ball. It'll then be pumped up and get you a prescribed PSI, and that PSI would translate into a velocity. Then when I pull down this bat, you're gonna wanna look right there. You get the swing of the bat, and what happens is then you'll see the outbound speed versus the inbound speed, and that'll give you that batted ball coefficient of restitution. And at the sweet spot will be where that batted ball coefficient of restitution is the greatest. Great, thank you guys.
Thank you so much to the Baseball Research Center for providing us some awesome insight at their baseball exhibit. It's time to move on to our next exhibit. Here reporting live from the Acton TV news team is Big Beryllium.
Would you like to say a few words about your exhibit to Acton TV?
Sure. I represent the Amateur Telescope Makers of Boston. We put on the star party here in Acton for the fourth graders.
Oh, I remember that. I used to go to those.
And so here's some pictures of astronomical objects taken by club members. These are all around here. They're not out west someplace. And in our exhibit, we're featuring, first of all, this telescope over here. This is going to be in the Acton Library. You can check this telescope out. Okay, so if you want to use it at home, check it out of the library like a book. And we're also demonstrating how a telescope works so students can understand how the lenses work and how a telescope works.
Well, thank you for introducing us to this. That's really cool that they allow people to check it out at the library.
Yep.
Do you know how long they loan it to you for? Like 1 week or?
I think a week, because there's so many people that want to do it. There's a big list of people backed up. But you can ask the library. Okay?
Thank you.
Hope you try it out.
I will. I'll really try. It would have been useful to have this on the lunar eclipse a couple of weeks ago.
It would have been, yep. Although you can see it with your eyes very well also. One of these pictures here is pictures of a lunar eclipse that our club members took. But anyway.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
So we're from Acton TV, and we were wondering if you guys would like to tell us a bit about your...
Sure. So we are the Acton Boxborough Regional High School Science Team, and my name is Riona Chen.
My name is Roshni Sahu, I'm Andrew Lee.
I'm Peter Wilson.
So this is Mission Possible. It's one of our building events, and here's the spec sheet. And so the basic design is you have to build a Rube Goldberg machine, which places six golf balls into this container down here. So the basic principle is like the golf ball wires, strings will come here and this will burn it. And so it will drop down here, switch this lever, and roll down into this container. So at the back, some like sand substance or maybe water will be placed into here, will fall down into this container, and then it has aluminum foil on the back, and this will trigger an electric circuit. Peter, do you want to explain robotic?
Okay.
Keep on explaining.
So, this one back.
Robot.
So this is a robot arm. This is a 2015-2016 season building event. The goal with this event is we have a playing field with a variety of objects on there. Dice, we have pencils, we have ping pong balls, etc. And we have to manipulate them and place them into right cards. We're doing it with this. We have several axes of freedom on this. We have an elbow. We're using a tendon system, which is currently non-functional. We have a shoulder, which also uses a tendon system. And we have a claw on the arm. These are potentiometers. They're angle sensors. In its final form, we're going to have both this arm and another smaller arm, which only has angle sensors attached. We also have a microcomputer hooked up to the arm with a breadboard on it that's going to control these motors on the arm. That way, when we move this arm, the angle sensors on this arm will be able to figure out what angle its joints are at and be able to tell this arm to match its position. That way, so in the competition, instead of playing around with batteries and leads, we can move our currently imaginary master arm and have this arm copy whatever it's doing. We will have the operational version of this at Science Family Night, November 20th, in case you're interested in coming back then.
We're coming to you live from the...
live
from...
Oh, this is amazing.
Did you have today?
Do you?
I had fun.
What was your favorite part about learning stuff?
Wait, is
today?
This fun?
About the.
Excuse me, sir. What was your favorite part of today?
I liked learning how the police can figure out fingerprints really easily if and since everyone has different fingerprints, they can match the ones that they found and they can find the crime person.
Do you like how Acton has these kinds of events?
Yeah. Most of them are really, really cool, like the but the bike.
Well, you heard it here first, folks. Excuse me, would you like to say a few words about this event?
Hi.
Okay.
Yeah, so basically this pen is a 3D doodler pen invented by that awesome guy sitting next to me. And basically what this does is there's a piece of plastic and it goes into the pen and it's pulled through and it gets really hot and then it is liquidized and you can, it's not coming out now of course when I'm on camera, but it supposedly comes out the end and then you can make stuff with it.
So what have you made here? Is this
a tree? Yeah, this is just a question. Hold on a second.
All right. Oh, it's coming.
So this is basically like a very intricate hot glue gun that squirts out creations, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm so awkward on TV.
No, it's all right. It's.
I think this one actually might have just...
No, yeah, it's been doing it all night.
Yeah,
this is... Okay, so this is an apple tree that I've been working on since 6:30.
What time is it now?
8:32. And, yeah, it's basically melted plastic. Kind
Would
of
you
like
to donate that to Acton TV?
Woo! No, I think it's going to go on her Instagram.
It's going on my Instagram.
Since we never got you shamelessly shouting out your Instagram and giving yourself a self-promo, would you like to give us a self-promo?
Yeah, sure. I'm Nala, and I post my art on Instagram on Nala Draws. NALADRAWS.
That's Nala Draws.
Nala Draws on Instagram.
Nala Draws, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah. Ask him how he created.
Yeah, ask him questions, because he's the inventor guy.
You can make two parts and then kind of like weld them together. Yeah. So you can make like flat pieces and then build up like a complex thing.
Victor's on.
Excuse me?
Oh, yeah.
We never got on tape the first time.
Oh, really? So okay.
Would you like to describe your...
Thing? Yeah, sure. So my name is Peter Dilworth, and I'm the inventor of this thing, which is called the Three Doodler. It's a pen that you hold like a normal pen, but it can draw in three dimensions and draw, for example, a tree. It uses melted plastic, kind of like a 3D printer. It's a fun way to just kind of make random doodles.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sure. Thank you.
So the pen is... $99 from Amazon, or you can get it at Michael's or Brookstone.
Hi.
And it's just a lot of fun. It's like a nice, fun toy to play around with. So.
All right. Thank you.
Hello. Could you give us a few little information about your exhibit?
Sure. These are thermal imaging night vision cameras. The little one will see about a half a mile, and that one will see about a mile. We've also taken them, so these help our soldiers own the night, so they can see at night. Franklin, why don't you tell them about, we also put it in a firefighting mask. Franklin will demonstrate what we did here.
So pretty much what we did is take the thing you saw before, and then we implemented it into a helmet of a firefighter, so that firefighters could see through smoke during fires, and then they could have their hands free to do other things. So this was really like a good thing for firefighters because
the thermal imager works, like you said, right through the smoke, so you can find somebody right in a burning building or smoking building. So it's very impressive technology.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good job, Franklin.
And anything heavy?
Hi, would you like to talk a little bit about your exhibit?
Sure. I'm Denise, and I'm from the Discovery Museum. And would you like to make a DNA necklace?
Sure.
So you take this little Eppendorf tube, put one squirt of the DNA. So what this is, we took strawberries, and we crushed them. We added salt, a solution with salt and with detergent to break out the cells, and then we strained it. This is alcohol, so slowly squirt that on there, fill it up till about just a little bit, about a millimeter lower than.
Yeah.
And that will take it out of solution.
Right.
That's good.
I think you're right. I mean, as we're starting to get smaller,
we're going
to start to change
and now
the way it interacts with
your cap on and then do it really tight.
Right, like if you dissolve, water.
All right.
And now chip it back and forth slowly. So it's not soluble in the alcohol, so it will start to collect the strands. If you do it gently, can you see in the bottom of that one? That's the strawberry's DNA. So it all tangles up with itself. And so so it's one way to show things at a very small scale. So you can't see. see the DNA, but if you were to magnify it, it's all coming together. And then we have iron filings, and we have gold and silver at a nanoscale, and they're very different properties. And that's the whole idea of nanotechnology, is that oftentimes when things are at a billionth of a meter or in the nanoscale, the properties are very unique and different, and we can take advantage of some of those and create some new technologies. So you can try this out.
That's very cool. Thank you so much, Denise, for talking about our exhibits for DNA and nanotechnology.
Hello. Could you give us a little information about your exhibit?
Sure. Mike and I are from the Bose Corporation, and we're talking about loudspeakers today and how they work and function and produce sound and music. So that's what we're doing.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Is that good?
Hello, could you give us a little information about our exhibit?
Hi, my name's Liana and this is Shannon. We're from Shark Ninja and we're here to talk about the new product development process at our company.
Okay.
Yeah. Anything else?
Like talk about your invention?
So here is our STEM Dec. It is one of the projects that she and I both work on. We were just discussing how we go from a prototype like this to a product that you actually sell on the market, and how from the prototype stage to the product, we do a lot of testing and we do a bunch of different iterations for our mop, because nothing's ever perfect the first time.
Okay, thank you.
Excuse me, would you like to say a few words about your exhibit for Acton TV?
Absolutely, yes, that'd be great. So we're basically showing the police aspect and our technological advancements that we have here. We start off with our stop sticks. So if we had a high-speed chase and we needed to deploy these to stop a vehicle for public safety issues, we'd hold the kite string and throw it out. Inside here, basically, are all sharp screws. All you have to do is drive over the plastic and the tires automatically pop, which is really neat. This is our new search tool. So it's an optic wand. You might be able to see on the screen, there's my mouth. And some teeth. So we use that now. Where we can't reach with our hands, we can use that to go inside glove compartments, what we call hides in the field. Anywhere in the car that we might be think they're hiding drugs or something that we're looking for, we use that now to go inside. This aspect of it is, a lot of it is between police and our medical response. We're usually the first people on scene because of the reason that we're on patrol most often. The firefighters are probably at the station with EMS. So this is our defibrillator system, and obviously it helps in CPR. Some of our portable devices that we use is our wand, which obviously is a metal detector. We have a portable breathalyzer system, which measures the blood alcohol content inside the body. This is our handheld portable radar. What we do is we shoot this off, it sends out a frequency. That frequency bounces off the car, comes back and measures the speed of the vehicle. That's our portables. This is all our instruments here, which are linked to the national database that shows us any registration, a license of anyone that's operating a vehicle or a missing person, anything like that. So we can pretty much link up to anyone in the country or any police department in the country as well and get a response from them as far as anything that we might be looking for, a missing person or something like that. Feel free to look around the cruiser. There's our computer systems up front, obviously links to the internet as well. And this is our new ballistic vest that just came out and its capability of stopping rifles now instead of just pistols. That's what we have on display here. Thank you guys very much.
Could you tell us about the interior?
Sure.
I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Why do you keep a very big gun next to the robber seat?
That's a locked up AR-15, so it's a civilian version. It's called AR-15. The military, they call it an M16. You know what this is? This is really neat. So when you walk around and that pedal's on the ground, you get to measure distance. So if there was a crash and I had to measure how far the tires were skidding, I'd put this on the ground and it would tell me that the car skid 10, 20, 30 feet. And that way we can determine how fast the car was going.
Oh.
Neat, right?
Can I see your gun?
Nope, the gun stays in the holster at all times. That's a safety decision, right? It's always going to stay in here no matter what. If we ever see a gun, what do?
Run.
We put our hands up and we get an adult. Okay? If you ever see one, that's a safety rule. You got to remember that at all times, okay? Hey, how you guys doing? So this is the inside of our cruiser. This is where we keep our M16. This is our AR-15 civilian version. It's obviously extremely well secured and locked in inside the police cruiser. This is the passenger side, driver's side. We have our computer system. I'll be able to click on the button. So right here is the database that we log into. We run the plate, run the state that it comes in, and then it gives us all the information about the driver or the registered owner of that vehicle. That's our, so each in the front and back, we have a radar detector system. We can hit which button we want. If a car is passing us or coming up from the rear, we can definitely be able to tell the speed of that vehicle as well. I'll go around the other side, and I will show you where the bad guys go.
Keep this thing forever.
So this is where a subject that has been arrested would go. We call it a half cage. There's a bulletproof glass right here inside of this. Hard plastic, just in case any substances, fluids, or anything like that, we'd be able to hose it off. It's easier to clean. If it was fabric, there'd be obviously a risk of contamination. So we use hard plastic for anything. No door handles in the cage here. Obviously, if they were upset, they wouldn't be able to break the glass. So it's all safety issues. Make sure the person's in here with seatbelt to be as safe and secure as they can. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, buddy.
Yeah, so that was a police car.
Hello, could you give us a little information about your exhibit?
Yeah, so we're the Acton Robotics team, and we're a member of the First Tech Challenge. So every year they present us with a different robotics challenge for a problem that we need to solve. This year a big component of it is taking balls like these and getting them into raised buckets. So currently our mechanism, it's still a work in progress, but we're going to have sweeper mechanisms down here at the bottom of our robot, which sweep the balls and blocks up into this, which is a centrifuge. So as we spin the balls and blocks around, we're going to shoot them out this tube here. So we work every year to complete these challenges, and we go to multiple competitions to test our robot out, and it's kind of like a team game. So we play against other robots, and we work together as a team to build this. We're completely student-run. We're not affiliated with the school at all, really. So, yeah, we're pretty proud of what we made here.
All right, thank you.
Yep. Excuse me, would you like to say a few words about your exhibit for Acton TV?
Well, it's my son is on the robotics team, and so he's here with the Lincoln Labs as part of the demonstration. So what they brought is robots that they've been building for competition, and they're at an early stage, so they have things to solve and things to work on, and they're demonstrating all the various robots that are going into that competition.
Would you like to say a few words about your exhibit for Acton TV?
Like what?
Just explaining your exhibit.
Well, basically, it's an FTC exhibition, I guess. FTC based on, it's a first technical challenge, which is like a robotics competition that we have. And it's mainly for high schoolers, but middle schoolers and like other grades can do it as well. And you basically create robots and compete it with other kids in the area, which is, so it's really cool that you get to learn different kinds of engineering, like from the electric engineering to software engineering to like mechanical, which is something I really like. And I guess it just really inspired me like for my future career path and taking what I've learned in school and seeing how it's actually implemented in the real life world.
What do you
kind of
do there?
Put this in.
So have you built these models or have you programmed any of these?
Yeah, so the two robots that are over here are ones that we've actually built. So this bigger one, which is like more of a square one, it's a bit more official that we use in actual matches, while the other smaller one is more of a prototype model that we tend to use to test out different ideas that we have and different mechanisms that we'll use in an actual competition. But yeah, everything's been like designed, coded, tested out by like kids. So.
And what role do the smartphones play in the robot?
So there's a smartphone that's connected to the robot itself, and there's another one connected to these like video game controllers. And basically, what the video game controller, so that's what like a person would use to tell what the robot what to do. And then the smartphones basically translate it to like lay terms, I guess, that how we want the robot to do something, and it communicates it to the robot into the way that it understands it. Like it translates the language of humans to robots.
All right, well, thank you for that.
Hello, could you give us a little information about your exhibit?
Hi, I'm Detective Keith Campbell. I'm a police officer with the Acton Police Department, and I'm here to demonstrate some of the evidence collection that we do at a crime scene. So if there's a crime committed, they'll call an investigator in to try and pull evidence from that scene, and that could be fingerprints, it could be blood, it could be some type of DNA evidence, it could be video evidence. I'm also going to talk to witnesses and try to figure out, one, what happened, two, who did it, so we can hold them responsible. So that's what I'm here to show. We deal with science on a daily basis, whether it's through the fingerprint analysis or, you know, chemical testing. I can test drugs that I may find at the scene to make sure they're actually the drugs they are, and it's a chemical reaction there. So there's science in every part of what we do. So it's pretty interesting.
Wow, that's very cool. Thank you.
You're welcome. Good luck.
Hello. How are you?
I'm great. Okay, so what my exhibit is green chemistry. So it's green chemistry, and so basically what we're doing is that we're showing like biomimicry, and what that is that connecting something from nature into like a technology that we use today. And so we had like a puzzle, and it's like a matching game. So what you do is you find a technology, and you have to connect it to something in nature. Yeah.
Excuse me, would you like to say a few words about your exhibit?
We think it's a great event, you know, it's a great opportunity. We think it's a great event, and it's our first time to be here, and we really enjoy this. Is it good? I don't know. So what was it? Oh, it's you! Oh my God. So you did this for your project.
No TV.
Please
okay.
Get your 3D printer.
Okay, sure. That's fine.
So if we get from a side shot, we can see that it is squirting it out in the shape of a squirrel. Yay. Squirrels. They collect acorns.
Could you give us a few words about your exhibit?
Sure. SOLIDWORKS is here today showing kids a couple engineering design challenges. We're showing them how to create a stronger coat hanger. And we simulate it on the CAD system. And then we do a real world crush test. And then we let the kids decide how to make the coat hanger stronger. And they come up with different ideas. We test it in the crush test again, and it's all fun.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
So, would you like to say a few words about your exhibit?
Okay. Hi, I'm Peg LeGendre, and I'm from the Cambridge Science Festival. And today we've brought with us our augmented reality sandbox. What it is a 3D Kinect camera that has been calibrated to know what the surface of the sand looks like, and now every second it's taking a picture in real time as people manipulate the sand and have the sand either go higher or lower. That gets resolved in a computer program, and then it gets thrown out through the shot through a projector, and that allows the sand gets different colors depending on the height of the elevation, and it also adds contour lines. It also has a water simulation effect, so that if you hold your hand about 8 inches above the sand, it will simulate a rain cloud, and water will rain down the side of the mountain. So if I hold my hand like that, you can see the water running down the side of the mountain. So it's used for watershed education, and to teach people about contour lines and topography. It's installed in a number of museums, maybe 30 museums across the world right now have developed these. It was originally developed at UC Davis, They put it online with open sourceware, and anybody can build it. So,
could you just show us how it works?
Sure. Well, you just, they're showing you actually, as they move the sand around and they wait, in between times it's changing colors and adding,
so it gets darker as you make the elevation higher.
Good. What are these? And then the water is also cooling down here, so I can... build an island, and eventually what will happen is the water will all run off the side of this and form a little island atoll over here.
Cool.
And this is just, it's just regular sand. So it's just regular sand, and the magic all happens in the computer
with this box thing. Wait, did you get that? Should we make any part? Well, how does it work?
You mean how does it work?
I know. I get that. We done?
This thing takes the elevation, and then the program makes all the fancy contour lines.
We done?
Sure. What would you like to say?
You have to explain the exhibit.
Okay.
Walk us through an exhibit. What's your favorite part about tonight?
My favorite part is that we get to learn a lot of new stuff that we never knew about, especially about the robotics, because there's lots of different companies and different organizations here that use the robotics, so it's really fun.
Overall, have you found anything here where you would actually be considering as a career path in the future?
Yes, especially iRobot.
Alright, well thank you. Would you like to say a few words about this event for Acton TV? Do you enjoy participating in these events?
Yes, I thoroughly enjoyed doing this. I entered here late, so I didn't get to see everything. But what I saw, I thoroughly enjoyed.
From what you saw, did you see anything that you might want to use as kind of a base of what you would want to be when you grow up, or as a career path?
I do love robotics and technology. Those I think I want to do for college and things.
All right, thank you. Excuse me, would you like to say a few words for Acton TV? Do you enjoy participating in these kinds of events?
Yes, I really do. It's a really fun and really motivating experience for children to see what they want to do when they're older.
Did you see anything here that you might want to consider as a future career path?
Well, I really like environmental engineering, and I know there are a couple of stations that were sort of like that, so I think I really want to look into that more.
All right, thank you.
We had very much a lot of fun today, and we appreciate you guys
very
watching.
Good time it was today.
We are having a raffle now.
The Bialas is sponsor of fun activities throughout the year. This is the fourth grade star party against them all.
Would you like to talk to us, tell a few things about your exhibit?
Sure. So this is a Tesla Model S. It's a fully electric car. It has a range of about 285 miles on charge. It'll 0 to 60, depending on the model you get, in as low as 2.8 seconds. And it drives like no other car. It's super smooth and super quiet. And it looks good.
How much is the horse?
This part right here. Like that's the engine or something?
Thank you.
Doo-doo.
Sorry.
Doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo.
Got my mind.
Okay, thank you.
So, hello, would you like to give us a few quick words about your
hello, I wonder if you could give us, like, restart. Oh.
grateful. You know, Beryl, I'm really grateful for this opportunity to work with all these amazing people.
My name's not Beryl, by the way.